Hey everybody, welcome back to the Overwatch channel on YouTube. I found this debate, I'm going to link to it in the description section below. It's called Death Is Not Final, it's from a YouTube channel. I think it's also from a TV series, maybe on PBS or something. Intelligence Squared debates. Usually they do political debates, it looks like, from their channel content, but they did do this one debate about the death experience. And it's still shot here. You can see Dr. Eben Alexander and Raymond Moody. The reason that I picked this debate over many is I haven't found any until now that deal strictly with scientists debating each other. So on one side here you have Raymond Moody and Eben Alexander. On the other side you have two scientists that claim to be skeptical, and they go at it for about an hour and 40 minutes or so. So interesting part about this debate is that religion is not involved here. This is strictly a debate of science. What's also interesting is, or kind of frustrating actually, is when these skeptical side of this debate team, I just don't understand why people can't use, even scientists, they seem to be able to not stick to some rules of logic here. So at one point in this debate, Dr. Eben Alexander brings up the contents of the University of Virginia study that were mostly contained in a book called Irreducible Mind. It's an 800-page book. It goes over the study of consciousness as that it can't be a local phenomena to the brain. It goes over all these scientific experiments that show that consciousness is non-local, meaning it does not come from the brain. It comes from something else, or we are something apart from the brain. So it also brings up this other study by some other doctor about psi phenomena. The counter debater, and I hate when they do this kind of stuff, because it's very annoying to see this kind of stuff go on. The guy on the opposing side immediately finds reasons to dismiss the second book, the book that from the doctor that studied psi phenomena, and he goes over some kind of reasoning for that. Although I haven't looked into that book, so I don't know if he was actually accurate, because I've caught them saying some very inaccurate things during this debate. The thing that struck me was that he completely blows off the contents of the Irreducible Mind book. Doesn't even address it. I'm kind of disappointed at Eben Alexander here, or Raymond Moody, for not being a little more fired up about this stuff and catching them in these errors, but I guess it's you can't Monday morning quarterback these things too much, because they're under a lot of pressure up there. There's a big audience watching them and everything, and they all do a good job, both sides, so it's kind of worth a watch. But the thing is that things like that annoy me, because when the side that claims to be, well, we're materialist scientists and we can back up everything we say with evidence, avoid things, then they're avoiding evidence, which means they're a bunch of bullshitters. So the other thing that struck me was, at one point, a woman in the audience gets asked a question, and she was asking a question I brought up in my last video. How do you explain people born blind that have visual experience during out-of-body experiences while they're in a death situation? So their body's in the hospital, they're flatlined, there's no brain activity, they claim that they came out of the body and they can see what's going on. Not only do people claim they can see during their death experiences or during death experiences, they claim they can see better than they ever could as a physical human. People that describe vision during this state of consciousness, being outside the body, claim to have 360-degree vision. Vision that is able to perceive colors that they can't verbally describe, because they don't exist here as they progress through the experience when they enter like the higher realms. Another thing that frustrates me is this constant thing. Well, we know the laws of physics. We know the laws of science. And, you know, you can't measure this. You can't measure it in the laboratory, so therefore it doesn't exist. Well, by its very definition, the science you're talking about is materialistic science based on the plane of existence that we perceive readily. So there are laws here that govern this, although with some glitches and some error correction apparently. And you can find that in books about quantum mechanics and astrophysics. You can find out that scientists will, you know, come to some concept that the universe we perceive easily is behaves very much like a simulation. Some scientists actually believe that it is rendered upon viewing it, so it doesn't. It's kind of like a energy and probability, and not really solid until you're looking at it, or until some consciousness is observing it. Does it behave like the world we live in, much like a video game? But anyway, back to this. So yeah, there's a claim of these material scientists that because we can't measure it, because X, Y, and Z is impossible, then, but how would they know, actually, logically, how would a higher plane of existence, a higher dimensional level, which physics says exists, they say that there are, that mathematically they can prove many more higher dimensions than ours are real. Yet, how can they say that the laws of physics that govern our universe would apply there at all? People come back from these death experiences and they say there's no concept of linear time. Vision is highly enhanced and not like physical vision. It is like a total awareness of everything around you and beyond. Anything you focus on, you seem to be able to perceive all of its essence. Colors that can't be described here. Well, we do know colors exist. Light exists outside of our eyeballs' ability to see. Before these colors were proven to exist, before we had flare cameras or infrared detectors and ability to see the ultraviolet, before any of that was possible, there could have been a scientist somewhere that theorized that light goes beyond what we can see. Was he wrong? No, he wasn't. It turns out he was correct. How do we know, if we can say there are these higher planes of existence, how on earth can we possibly measure them with three or four dimensional science based in the rules of our ability to measure here in this plane? Why would these rules apply anywhere else? Even our rules of logic. Do our rules of logic apply outside of here? I'm a gamer. I like to play games. Sometimes I ponder the philosophical question of why, if this is like a rendered, reduced reality for us to experience for some reason, why would we experience it? Why is there so much suffering, evil in the world that we can see? Why are people assholes? And then I remember that, you know, as a gamer, I enjoy experiencing rendered realities, albeit much less real than what we perceive here. But then again, people that die and come back say that the reality they came into was much more real than this one. You see where I'm going with this? So as I'm playing whatever game, I'm in a virtual environment. Not only am I in a virtual environment that the gaming station, PlayStation, renders for me as I'm playing, or it could be an Xbox, whatever, if you're a computer gamer, it's on the PC. Where you're looking at is rendered, and where you're not is not rendered. It's not there. But why? Because it saves energy. And some scientists actually believe that our reality is rendered like that. And it has like error correction and glitches. I definitely think that the universe does have, although as amazing as it is, does have a few bugs and glitches occasionally show up. There are leaks. There are, you know, we instinctively are aware that our consciousness lives on after death. We've always been aware of that. We've always tried to spiritualize it, but we don't understand it. As for the scientists that want to put our brains in a box and think that they can convert us to some kind of artificial intelligent beings, I think they're fucked up, because I don't think consciousness is in the brain and therefore they can play around with this crap all they want, and it'll never work. There's no amount of computers that can compute to a point where it becomes conscious, because they don't even understand the scientists making these machines are believing a false belief. You know, people were probably able to sail long before Columbus got to the Americas, to the continent over here. People were able to sail. The Vikings probably came here first. And before that, who knows? There's even some evidence that as far back as the Egyptian time, there was some kind of possibility that there was ships that sailed to the South America, which, you know, they believe that because I think they found some cocaine in a mummy's system that could only have come from this side of the world. But the point is that those people may have been under the impression the Earth was flat. Doesn't mean that they can't sail to America and back. And just because we can make machines that are elaborate and can even mimic intelligence to a point, none of them are actually intelligent. None of them can break out of that mold of just being a machine, because the scientists building them, even though they can make machines that do amazing things, simply aren't grasping where consciousness comes from. So I'm not too worried about the AI taking over the world, because the AI, the way they're building it, can't work. So back to this debate. I'm going to link to it in the description section below. It's quite interesting. And I hope you take the time to watch it. I'm about to finish it soon here. I'm at 1 hour and 26 minutes into it. Thought I'd make this video. At the end, they're supposed to take a vote. I don't know who's going to win. I don't think it matters, because you can vote that something doesn't exist. It doesn't mean that it doesn't exist. So, but I do wish that certain things were caught during these debates. Like, I hate when... See, okay, the guy on the opposing team, when he's asked a question about the blind girl... or blind people, blind from birth, they always say the same thing when they're confronted with that kind of information. You would think that you're a scientist and one of these guys on the opposing side actually is a professional skeptic. So you would think that a professional skeptic would have a ready answer as to explain how people born blind have visual experiences during a death experience. And what is his answer during this debate? Oh, I haven't heard about that, or I don't know about it. I don't know enough about it to answer. They always use that cop-out when they run into that wall that they can't go past, because, oh, if they even touch that wall, you know, it's big problems for the skeptic. And that is one of the things that annoys me greatly. And while we're mucking it around in this reality, trying to figure out what's going on, it takes a lot of effort to drudge through all this crap to try to get to the truth. And we're constantly distracted by work, by people that want to have us consider what they think is true, and people that have agendas and cabals and elites that may be trying to manipulate the system. I mean, you can't even watch the news anymore. It's totally unwatchable. It's not even news. So that's it. I hope you watch the video below. It's kind of interesting. I'll talk to you later. Bye.